Welcome to Camarillo United Methodist Church. We're glad to be joining together in worship this morning, and every morning that we come together in celebration and in worship, it's always a joy to be here. Just want to take a moment to remind you to fill out the connection card, which is the back portion of the worship bulletin that you should have received as you have come in. Just fill out that back portion, letting us know that you're joining us in worship this morning. that back portion. The name goes on this side. Whatever prayer concerns that you may have, if you write that in and then tear this portion off and put it into the offering basket at that time, goes to our prayer team that lifts up your prayers. So even if you're a regular attender, to write your name and tear that portion off, greatly appreciate it. If you're new or visiting, whatever information that you can provide, we greatly appreciate that so that we know that you're joining us in worship this morning. And for those of you who are joining us online, we invite you to go to our church website and to fill out the online connection card letting us know that you're joining us in worship this morning and to download the worship bulletin so you can follow along in the worship service. And again, for those who are new to our church this morning, we welcome you, extend a special welcome. If you have any questions about the ministries and the programs of this church, feel free to inquire. And if you do not have a church home, we hope that you consider making Camarillo UMC your church home. With that, I have a few announcements to share before we get started. Let's see, where am I? There it is. The Endowment Committee has scholarships to give out to college and graduate students. And so if you know of college or graduate students that are members of this church that are attending school, we invite them to fill out the application for the scholarship. It is online now, so just go to our website, look for something like that, just click on it. It has a fillable PDF form for them to submit their information, and the Endowment Committee will be assessing that later on in the month. The typical deadline on the application says July 1st, but we extended it to the end of August. So we encourage our college and graduate students to apply for scholarship. And last week we announced that we have the first of our classes, our music classes. That's been part of our dream to start a music academy here at Camarillo. We have those three classes starting up next month. We have a strings class, we have a chimes class, and we have a mallet class. But between Miss Dory, Miss Christie, and we actually have an outside teacher, Miss Trina, who's leading the strings class. These are ways in which we are offering music education to our community. And so we invite you to, if you know of children from ages 4 to 11 who may be interested in this, it's an extension of our Crescendo Music Camp that has been so successful for the past couple of years. Information is going to be on the website. It's half built right now. The registration will be probably up by the 20th, which is in 2 days. It'll be up in 2 days. And so, but spread the word. Next. All right. We have a special class that Dr. Bill Garlington and I will be leading starting next week. It's a three-part class on the conflict that's happening in Israel and Palestine, between the Israeli and Palestinian conflict. Now, because of the sensitivity of the topic, the controversial nature of it, this class is actually not going to be recorded, and it will not be on the website. The last time we put on, we taught controversial topics and put it on the website, man, we got a lot of hits and a lot of comments. You know, so it's like, you know what, we understand this is very controversial. What we're presenting is the history of understanding what has led up to the current state. It is meant to be unbiased. It is not pro-Palestinian or pro-Israel. It's to understand the context of what is going on and to have a better understanding of the conflict. Not to say that the conflict is good. That's nowhere, there is no way we're saying that. But to at least understand where people are coming from, both the Palestinians and Israelis. So that is a three-part class starting next Tuesday at 6:30 in the Mission House for 3 weeks. Okay, and the next after that, save the date for September 8th. That is our fall kickoff. And this year, we're doing it a little differently than previous years. Instead of our typical ministry fair that we used to have, we are actually going to have an all-church picnic up at Cam Heights Elementary School. So it'll be right after church. We're going to head over there. It is going to be a potluck. We'll provide the main dish, and we hope that you all bring your desserts or sides or whatnot. There'll be games. There'll be bingo. gotta have bingo, right? There's music, entertainment, food, fellowship. It'll be a wonderful way to kind of start off our fall season. So keep that date in mind. It's September 8th. That's in a few weeks, from 11 to 1 o'clock. It'll be right after church. All right? We are always grateful for the gift of altar flowers, and today's flower is given by Patty Robinson in loving memory of her son, Craig Robinson. And so we want to lift Patty up in prayer, and may God continue to bless her with cherished memories of her son. And one last announcement. Dr. Hillary Ling has his camera with him today. There it is. Big camera. That means that he will be in the social hall after church to update any new information, or if you just want to replace your photo in our church directory. So if you haven't already taken your picture for the church directory or want to take a newer picture, Dr. Hillary Ling will be in Brooks Hall with our photo shoot studio there, right? Okay. With that, I'm going to invite you to stand as you're able. Turn your attention to our liturgist, Ricard Lemmer, as he leads us in the call to worship.
Praise the God of love. Praise the God of hope. Praise the God of new beginnings. Please join in singing our opening hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. The words will be on the screens. It can also be found on page 384 of our United Methodist hymnal.
Joy of heaven. Sunday. We are looking forward and getting ready for a brand new school year. How many of you already started last week? Did some of you start already? Yeah? All right, how'd they look? No worse for the wear? How many people are starting like this coming week? So some of both, huh? And how are we feeling about starting school? How do you feel about starting school, Grace? Grace is kind of in the middle, all right. Eleanor, how are you feeling about starting school? Shh. Kind of on the side, kind of down. Do we have any thumbs up for starting school?
It's too hard to wait.
Now that's what you want to hear, right? Yeah, so starting school brings up all kinds of emotions, doesn't it? Some people are very excited to start. You get to go see your friends again after maybe not seeing some of them for the summer. You get to start a new grade and learn some cool new things. Sometimes when you move up to the next grade, there's some new things you get to learn and try, right? Great.
I'm getting a computer.
You're getting a computer. That's something to be excited about, huh? Yeah. So there are a lot of things to be excited about with starting school, but sometimes you can always also be kind of nervous about starting school, right? Do any of you feel a little nervous about starting school? Yeah? Yeah? Starting new things is always kind of scary, isn't it? Do you have to meet new people? How many people like meeting new people? Yeah. I like meeting new people, but sometimes when there's a lot of new people, it can feel a little overwhelming. So sometimes I do get a little nervous about it. And you have a whole new teacher. Getting to know a new teacher can sometimes be scary, can't it? Well, there are lots of teachers that are very nice and patient, but you don't know that until you meet them. Like there's a whole bunch of kids that are very lucky to have Mrs. Binney and Mrs. Kim this year, but they might not know it yet. They might not know how lucky they are. And Mrs. Kelly. I forget that you teach outside of the church sometimes. So sometimes starting school can bring a lot of emotions. And being nervous is okay. It's okay to be nervous to start new things. Because we don't know what it's going to be like yet, right? So one way that I like to help myself with new things is I feel better if I'm prepared, right? If I go into a new thing prepared, it makes me feel a little less nervous. So preparing for school. What are some ways to prepare for school? You can learn who your teacher is ahead of time, right? How many of you already know who your teacher is going to be? Yeah, that helps, doesn't it? It can help to start practicing going to bed early so you can get up in the morning. Yeah, doesn't that help? That's one of the hardest things about starting school, isn't it? Getting up early. Yes, Eleanor.
You go to bed in the morning.
Oh, no. And you got to make sure you have everything you need, right? You got to make sure you have all your supplies ahead of time. When I was in school, I loved the first day of school because I got, well, before the first day of school, I got to go shopping and buy all new clothes. I loved having a new outfit for the first day of school. How many of you had a new outfit for the first day of school? Yeah, you still do that? Yeah. And you go to Target, you pick out all your new school supplies. So everybody has their backpacks today, right? I have my backpack. I'm going to show you some of the things I have packed, and you tell me if you have some of the same things.
We don't have anything.
What are you going to take to school, though? I have paper and pencils, brand new paper and pencils. Do you still use paper and pencils in school?
Yeah.
Okay, good. It's nice to have a brand new set, isn't it? So it's kind of reminding you that this is a fresh start, that this is a new year full of all new possibilities, right? So I have my new paper and pencils. What else is down here? Do you use these?
Yeah.
I use these a lot. Do you use these, Emma? An eraser? This is my little reminder that even if I make mistakes, I can erase it. And I can try again, right? I like that. That's why I use pencil a lot instead of pen, because I like knowing that I can erase it and start again. Yes, Eleanor. Yeah, that's another way to do it, huh? And I have a fresh new box of pencils.
Crayons,
thank you. It helps to look at what I'm holding in my hand, does it? Yeah, and this just kind of reminds me that life is better with color, isn't it? Life is better when you add a little color to it. Let's see, what else is in here? Oh, my favorite picture of John Wesley. Do you all have your picture of John Wesley packed?
No.
So why do I have a picture of John Wesley packed in my backpack?
Because
I like John Wesley. Yes, I do like John Wesley. Does anybody know who John Wesley is? Ah, this group back here knows. Good. So, as you may have heard, I was in London this summer with a youth group, and part of our reason for going was to learn more about John Wesley. He's the man that started the Methodist Church. He's the founder of our church. And there are a lot of really cool things about John Wesley, but I learned one in particular that I really liked. So he lived back in the 1700s, and back in those days in England, a lot of kids had to work in order to make money for their families. So, Whitney, you're probably about old enough to go work in the factory. So 6 days a week, from morning until night, the kids would work in the factory to make money so that their family had a place to live and food. And so they didn't get to go to school. And John Wesley did not think this was good. He thought education is very important to children's future. So at his church, he started what was called Sunday school. And at our church, we have Sunday school, and we learn about the Bible, and we learn about God. But at John Wesley's Sunday school, it was literally a school that was on Sunday. So the kids could learn to read and write and do math so they could have a better future. So my picture of John Wesley is in my backpack to remind me to be thankful that I live in a time when we all get to go to school instead of working in a stinky factory all day. Right? Doesn't that sound better? All right, let's see what else I have in here. I think I have one more thing in here. I have... I have snacks. How many of you pack snacks to go to school?
I do.
Yeah? It's good to have snacks. It keeps your brain working when it gets food during the day, right? But I have a lot of snacks.
That's too many.
Because snacks are not only good for feeding your brain so that you can concentrate at school, but they're good for sharing, right?
And it's good for energy.
And it's good for energy, right, Grace? So I brought enough fruit snacks to share with everybody. Because coming up in these next few weeks, we're going to be learning about being a good neighbor at church. You saw Pastor Albert had pictures up there earlier of being a good neighbor of houses. And I think sharing your fruit snacks is a good way to be a good neighbor at school, right? Do you think there are other kids at school that are feeling kind of nervous about starting school?
Yeah.
Do you think there are some kids who are new and don't know anybody and are kind of scared? Yeah. So sharing with other people is a good way to be a good neighbor. Maybe there's someone at school who needs a smile, that are having a hard day and they just need you to smile at them and say, "Hi, how are you today?" One second, Eller. Maybe they need somebody to talk to them. If they don't know anybody at recess or at lunch, maybe they need somebody to talk to them or someone to play with them to say, "Hey, we started a game. You want to be in the game with us?" So those are some ways that we can be good neighbors at church. And John Wesley, my good buddy, he had a lot to say about being a good neighbor. In fact, the words that he said about it are up on the wall in Brooks Hall. If you ever take the time to look at the words,
yeah,
it says, all right, if you know them, say them with me, okay? It says, "Do all the good you can by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can." So basically, all the time, right? Help people all the time. And another person you may know has a quote about what he says about being a good neighbor, Jesus. And in the book of Mark, somebody asks Jesus, "What are the most important commandments? What are the things that I absolutely have to do?" A commandment is something that you should do, right? And Jesus said there are two commandments that are greatest of all. The first one is, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength." And the second greatest commandment is to love your neighbor as yourself. So to treat the people at school like you would want to be treated. If you would want someone to be kind to you, you should be kind to other people, right? And we're going to go to Sunday school. Before we do, we're going to bless those backpacks. And we have something a little extra for your backpack. We're going to give you all this little clip that you can put on your backpack. And this is the other thing I want you to remember today. I want you to remember to be thankful for school, that you don't have to work in a factory. I want you to remember to be a good neighbor to other people while you're at school. And I want you to remember while you're at school that even on the hard days, God is with you. God will be with you to help guide you through that day, even if it feels like, "Oh, I don't think I can make it through this day." You can't. because he's with you. And they say things like, always pray and never give up. And for with God, nothing shall be impossible. So you can see what ones you're saying it. Pastor Albert, do you want to do the blessing?
Sure. I need two over here.
You're going to need two over there. Okay.
So afterwards, we can have the teachers help pass out these little clips that we can clip on our backpacks so that we know we're always reminded that God is with us when we go to school. But we always take this time in the year to bless all of our children. We don't necessarily bless the backpacks. We bless the folks wearing the backpacks. So we're going to have a word of prayer together. I want all the congregation to participate by kind of putting out your hands and kind of like send your good energy, God's spirit, towards all of our children as we lift them up in prayer. Okay, let us all pray together. Well, gracious, loving God, we are truly grateful to you for all of our children and our teachers as they start the new school year. Lord, every step of the way, you are with us. You guide us from the earliest when we begin to walk and talk and to learn new things. You are there, and you are the ones that have provided us with opportunities to learn, to provide us with the teachers and the schools in which we attend. Lord, we pray that as we start off this new year, that your Holy Spirit be upon each and every one of our children, that they will grow, that they will learn, and that they will become faithful disciples of you, faithful citizens, good neighbors to one another, good students. We pray that you will just watch over them, that everything that they learn, that they will use to help each other and to make this a better world. Lord, we also lift up prayers for all of our teachers. We pray for your gift of strength, of patience, and just wisdom to share upon all the students. We give you thanks, O God, and we pray that this year will be a great year for every one of them, for every one of our children, for every one of our teachers, for our church, for the schools. May this be a blessed year that your Holy Spirit blesses us with. We give you thanks and pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Though I may speak with answers, our spirits long to be made whole. Let's inward love guide every deed. By this we worship and are freed.
Amen. Isn't it wonderful to have wonderful children in our midst and to be able to worship together and to be able to bless them as they all start off their new school year? And just a little tidbit of information. As Ms. Christie shared, our school system, a lot of people don't realize that our school system, our public school system, came out of the church. The Sunday schools became what has become public school. So this whole idea of learning and education, it all started in the church. And definitely John Wesley was one of the forefronts who started that education process for the public. We come to a time now as we to lift up prayers for our neighbors, for the world, for our congregation. So I invite us to be in an attitude of prayer. Let us bow our heads. O God of mercy and of love, we give you thanks, O God, for this wonderful and precious day in which we come together to worship. We come as a people yearning with passion to know you and to know one another, O God. Help us to live according to your call upon us to be a community where our claims of having open hearts, open minds, open doors truly rings true. Lead us in knowing our neighbors, O God. Open our hearts that we may truly be a community of love.
accepting all for who they are, as you have accepted us for who we are. Grant us hearts that yield compassion for our neighbors, and grant us hearts of generosity that give to those who are in need. And give us hearts that forgive those who may have hurt us, as well as hearts of courage to seek forgiveness from others when we have hurt them. Lord, help us in building relationships for the sake of building your kingdom. May we remain faithful and strong in the midst of life challenges, O God. We continue to lift up prayers of concerns that weigh heavy on our hearts. We pray for Keith Grimm as he recovers from surgery, O Lord. May your healing hands be upon him that his body may be restored to its full health once again. Be with Michael and the medical professionals providing the care for which Keith needs. We continue to lift up prayers for Nadine Wilhite as she continues to seek healing and recovery from her fall. Lord, provide her with your strength and the right care facility to give her the proper place in which she can heal. Grant her patience as she settles back home from her trip. We also lift up prayers for Terry Bouchard on the passing of his sister. Lord, grant him peace in his heart and the assurance of faith in trusting in your promise of resurrection and eternal life. Grant him peace and hope of knowing that Carol is in your eternal care. And we continue to pray for those in our congregation continue to receive care. We pray for Evelyn Williams' recovery. May your healing presence embrace her and restore her body to its full health as well. And we continue to lift up prayers for Valerie Tho, who is with us this morning. Continue to give her strength and endurance as she goes through her treatments. Be with all the medical staff, the doctors and the nurses that provide care for each and every one of them. Lord, there are other prayers that we hold deep within our hearts. Receive them as we lift them up to you in silence at this time. O God of mercy and of peace, hear our prayers, O Lord. May we continue to strive to open our hearts wider than we've opened before. Help us to truly see in the lives of others not only your act of creation, but the very presence, your presence within them. Lead us in living our lives reflective of your love, and continue to work towards building a world that you have envisioned. We pray all this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We are always so grateful for all the gifts and blessings that God bestows upon us, and these opportunities to gather and to be of community, as well as to extend that community to our beyond the walls of the church. We pray that God continues to gift us in ways that we help those beyond the walls of the church. And so with that, I invite the ushers to come forward that we may give of our gifts, tithes, and our offering for the ministry that needs to happen in the world today.
Day, and with each passing moment,
strength I find to meet my trials here. Trusting in my Father's wise bestowment, I've no cause for worry or for fear. And His heart is kind beyond all measure, gives unto each day what He deems best. Lovingly is part of pain and pleasure, mingling toll with peace and rest. The Lord Himself is near me with a special mercy for each hour. All my cares He fain would bear and cheer me. He whose name is Counselor and Power, the protection of His child and treasure, is a charge that on Himself He laid. As thy days, thy strength shall be in measure, this the pledge to me He made. Thy promises, O Lord, that I lose my faith's sweet consolation, offered me within thy holy word. Help me, Lord, when toil and trouble meeting, or thou take as from a Father's hand. One by one, the days, the moments fleeting, till with Christ the Lord I stand.
Please join in praying together the prayer of dedication shown on the screens. God of justice and love, transform these offerings that they may be gifts of justice and love for a world in need of hope and help. Let love flow through these offerings that they may become gifts of love for the world. Amen. Our scripture reading comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 12, verses 28 to 34. Listen to Mark's account of Jesus teaching the great commandment to love God and to love our neighbors. One of the scribes came near and heard them disputing with one another, and seeing that Jesus answered them well, he asked him, "Which commandment is the first of all?" Jesus answered, "The first is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. Then the scribe said to him, "You are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one, and besides him there is no other. And to love him with all the heart, and with all the understanding, and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself, this is much more important than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." After that, no one dared to ask him any questions. May the Lord bless the reading and hearing of the Holy Scripture. Amen.
Amen. Please join me in a word of prayer. Most gracious, loving God, we give you thanks as we come together at this time to reflect upon the passage that we have just heard and to just glean from you, O God, from your Spirit, guidance, direction in our lives, in living as your disciples. Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit fill this place in which we gather and fill the hearts with the space within our hearts, whether we are here or watching us online, then no matter where we are, God, may your Holy Spirit speak to us now. Open up our ears, our hearts, and our minds to be receptive to what you have to say. And we ask that the meditations of all of our hearts and the words of our mouths be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our Redeemer. In Christ's most holy name we pray. Amen. So there's a story about a young man who, let's call him John, who was showing off his new apartment to his friends. And his friend asked, "So, hey John, what's that gong doing in the corner over there?" And John replied, "Well, that's not a gong, that's a talking clock." The friend said, "A talking clock? Like Alexa?" And John said, yeah, but you don't have to plug it in." So now the friend was intrigued and asked, "Really? How does it work?" And so then John went over and said, "Watch." He picked up a sledgehammer and he hit that gong real hard. And then a voice on the other side of the wall screamed out, "Knock it off, you idiot, it's 2 a.m. I'm not sure what kind of a neighbor John is. There's another story though, a real one, about an incident that happened years ago in Canton, Ohio. Firefighters were called to the home of a young 24-year-old woman. She was your typical young adult, you know, trying to get ahead in life and trying to establish herself. But she had a neighbor. She had a neighbor that she just couldn't see eye to eye. And the tension between them got really bad. It caused her a lot of grief. And so she sought ways to deal with this neighbor, which might not have been the best way, best of decisions. You see, when the firefighters arrived and finally extinguished the fire in her home, they found, what they found was a smoldering voodoo doll made with cloth and twigs, which she admitted she had been using to cast spells against the neighbor. And then it caught on fire. It was all at the advice that she got from some telephone psychic hotline. It was a true story. Unfortunately, it's unfortunate, right? Unfortunately, we seem to be living in times that I wonder, you know, how people get along, you know, when people can't really get along with others. Not just individuals, but we have nations building walls to keep neighboring nations out. We have right now two active wars, if not other neighboring nations, you know, fighting over territories, right? And even within our own nation, people in cities cry out, not in my backyard, when it comes to building homes for the homeless or low-income housing. And most people go about their day disconnected from others. Maybe, you know, except for maybe a small, tight-knit group of individuals that they hang out with. But for the most part, people keep their distance. You know, book writer Jonathan Franzen once wrote, "The American family today is a tiny nuclear unit inhabiting an enormous house in which every person has his or her own room, bedroom, with a bathroom. It is no longer a rule that you know your neighbors. Communities increasingly tend to be virtual, and participants either are faceless or firmly in control of the face that present to others, aka avatars, right? And in Los Angeles, transportation is largely private. The largest SUV is the size of a living room. Yeah, that comes with onboard communications and TV screens where people inside people sit behind tinted windows of one of these high riding, I can see you, but you can't see me, mobile privacy guard units," end quote. Isn't that true? Is it true? We live in these isolated world, and we wonder why society is so troubled. There's crime and violence, children and elderly at risk, and people struggling with mental health. So, in the next few weeks, next several weeks, we're going to be looking at a new series, called "Won't You Be My Neighbor?" Now, the staff wanted me to wear a red cardigan for this series. I gotta love my staff, right? Christy and Dory and Janet and all of them. They're like, "You gotta get a red cardigan." And I'm like, "It's 80 degrees. I'm not gonna be wearing a cardigan." I wore a red shirt today. All right? Maybe if I was doing the series in cooler weather. But this series, you know, okay, so it's "Won't You Be My Neighbor?" But it actually is based upon a book that I read some years ago called "The Art of Neighboring," in which I hope that this can help us think about how we live as community. In the book, the authors share a story of why neighboring is such an important issue. The authors are actually two pastors from different churches in Denver, Colorado area, Denver area. And they tell of a time back in 2009 when they gathered a bunch of clergy to have a meeting with the mayor of the city. They asked for this meeting so they can discuss some of the issues, some of the societal issues happening, including things like at-risk kids, you know, areas with dilapidated housing, you know, drug and alcohol abuse, you know, elderly care that no one seems to be looking after, and so on. All these issues, they kind of brought it forward. And they thought that they were being good community leaders to bring these matters in front of the mayor and expected him to start some program, right, to address these problems. But instead, the mayor said, "The majority of the issues that our community is facing would be eliminated or drastically reduced if we could just figure out a way to become a community of great neighbors." That's what the mayor said. In other words, what he was saying is that government programs are not the most effective way to address societal issues. Relationships are. He said, "When neighbors are in relationship with one another, the elderly person is checked in on by their neighbor next door. The at-risk kids get mentored by parent neighbor across the street, and so on." Essentially, the mayor responded to a bunch of pastors, "You know, the solution to our world problems is actually what Jesus said, love your neighbor." In our passage today, we read, the passage that we read today, a scribe goes up to Jesus and asks him, "Teacher, which of the commandments, which is the greatest commandment of all?" And Jesus pretty much says, "Listen, all the 613 laws of Judaism can be summed up in these two statements. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these." If you don't have time or the willpower to read through the whole Bible, just remember that. That just sums it up, right? That I'm giving you a pass from reading the Bible. No, read the Bible, but if you don't have enough time or just want to go, get the Cliff Notes version, that's what Jesus is giving us. Love God, love our neighbor. Now, we can pretty much figure out what it means to love God, right? We do that by being good people, worship regularly, read the scripture, pray continuously. We love God by following those commandments. But how about loving our neighbor, loving your neighbor? What does that mean? If you remember, there was that famous passage, right? One of the most well-known parable that Jesus tells, right? Of the Good Samaritan. And in the context of that parable, a lawyer goes up to Jesus and asks, "Who is my neighbor?" He's trying to justify himself. Who is my neighbor? Who do I need to really love and who can I not love? Who can I ignore? Right? Well, the literal translation of a neighbor is the person right next to you. That's basically what the literal translation is. Right? So turn to one another and say, "Hey, neighbor, do you love me?" Do you guys say that? Do you say, "Hey, neighbor, do you love me?" Or you guys drop the second part? Well, I see some couples are like, "Yes, I love you." And others are like, "I don't know." There's a story about an elderly woman who was passing away at a hospital. Her son flew in to be with her. He walked over to her bedside, kissed her on the cheek, and said, "Mom, you've been such a good mother to me, and I want you to know that I love you." And with that, the woman started crying. And through her tears, she said to her son, "Last Friday was your 63rd birthday, and this is the first time you ever told me that you love me." Sometimes we don't say those words enough. Right? I love you. Especially to those who are close to us, especially family members. And when was the last time you said that to your neighbor? Well, that kind of sounds weird. But still, you understand the context. Probably one of the reasons why some people treat their neighbors poorly is because we treat ourselves and those close to us, our families, poorly. Loving your neighbor starts with those immediately around us. You see, often we think, sometimes we take these commandments, these teachings of Jesus, and we think of grandiose, the context, right? When he says, "Love your neighbor," we think of, okay, then let's care for those who are in a distance. Caring for the oppressed in foreign lands or those in poverty in third world countries or those we hardly know the names of on the streets. That's good. I mean, that's important. We need to love them as well, but we cannot hide behind helping those far away and neglect those literally our neighbors right next to us. And unfortunately, what the mayor from Denver said was, from the city's perspective, this is what he said, quote, "From the city's perspective, there isn't any notable difference in how Christians and non-Christians treat their neighbors in the community." That's what he said. So, we're going to do a little exercise, right? Do you know your neighbors? Do you know your neighbors? Here's a little chart, right? looks like a tic-tac-toe. My media team folks said, oh no, it's Sudoku. Fine, okay, so call it Sudoku or tic-tac-toe. But in the middle of this nine squares, in the middle you see a square with a house, right? So think of that as that's your home. Whether it be your apartment or your a house, a single family dwelling or something whatnot. So that's your home. And then look at these squares around it. The squares on top, right? The square right on top, the middle one on top, where that's directly across the street. The squares on the corners are those that are diagonally, you know, from you. And the squares that are on the left and the right are basically your neighbors on your left and your right. And the squares on the bottom are basically the neighbors that are behind you or, you know, across the backyard. Okay, so you kind of get an idea, right? So think of it geographically. Now, here's the exercise. Do you know your neighbors? For each of those other boxes, ask yourself three questions, A, B, C. One, or A, do you know their names? B, do you know something about them? You know, besides their name, like, you know, what do they do for a living? Or, you know, just, you know, how many, you know, what do they do? Right? Things like that. But C, the question from C is, do you know their hopes and their dreams? In other words, do you know something about them that only comes from actually having a conversation, a deeper conversation beyond just a hey neighbor, right? Do they go to church? What are their concerns in life? What are their hopes? What are their dreams? Think about it. I'm going to give you a few minutes to just kind of go through each of your neighbors in front, on the sides, diagonally, behind it. Do you know their names? Do you know something about them? Do you know their hopes and dreams or concerns in life? Now, how many of you are able to fill out all eight boxes? Oh, one. You've been living in the same house for 40 years, right? No. But that's good. Now, how many are able to name at least all three in at least three of the boxes? Good. Five boxes? Okay. Good. Six boxes? Right? Maybe the ones in behind is harder, right? Now, I got to tell you, I'm sort of at a disadvantage. And the whole reason why this whole neighboring thing came to mind for me was because, as you all know, I just moved into a new home. So I've only been there for 2 weeks now. But I got to tell you, I'm getting excited to get to know who my neighbors are. And sometimes it's easier as a new neighbor moving in to be able to go next door and knock on the door. It's like seeing someone at church. You've seen them all this time, but you don't know their name. So you're afraid to ask what their name is, right? Don't worry. Just ask them. I'm sorry. What's your name again? Yeah, you can do that. But again, for me, I'm moving into a new neighborhood, and I'm really excited I get to do this. You see, you know, what my hope is that once I get, you know, settled in, I'll have the opportunity to gather our neighbors together and have gatherings, you know, Bible studies, whatnot. But get to know the neighbor. You see, if we truly want to be disciples of Jesus, then we need to take his commandment seriously. And when he said to love your neighbor, he meant to really love them, to get to know them, have a relationship with them. And Jesus did so usually by sitting down with them, breaking bread with everyone that he met, both Jews and Gentiles, sinners and Pharisees, tax collectors and zealots. As Christy said, sharing a meal breaks down walls and usually creates that connection. Inviting others to share in a meal is probably the best way to get to know the other person. And like I said, my hope is that once I settle in, you know, clear out the boxes in the garage and in the backyard, and actually it looks presentable. My plan is not only to have a month-long open house for all of you all to come visit the home that you all helped me establish, but my hope is to have guest parties
for those in the neighborhood. You know, who knows, like I said, we'll have gatherings or small groups or Bible studies in the pastor's home. Oh, how about that? Bible study in the pastor's home. Anyhow, let me close with this story. We've all heard of the name William Penn, right? We all know who William Penn is, right? He's the one that the state of Pennsylvania is named after. Well, when he was given the land in the New World by King Charles II, not the current one, you know, back in 1681, he was also given the power to make war with the Indians, right? But William Penn refused. He refused to build forts or to have soldiers in his province. Instead, he treated the Native Americans kindly and as equals. They shared in common meals often, and when there was a dispute, it was settled by having six Europeans and six Native Americans at a table together. Not lopsided, not just, okay, here's our council, one of you come and tell us what you, no. He said it as equals. When William Penn died, the American Indians mourned him as a friend. Now, the other colonies were constantly under attack by the Indians, but Pennsylvania was free from such attacks as long as they refused to arm themselves. But many years after Penn's death, and when the Quakers, you know, which was, you know, William Penn was a Quaker, the society, when they were outvoted in the state, and the colony began building forts and training soldiers, you can guess what happened next. Immediately began the conflicts and the attacks. You see, William Penn understood that the key to all human relationships is to just love others as ourselves. And when we treat others with love and get to know them, the world can be a better place without war or conflict. Here's hoping, right? So in the next few weeks, my hope is that at least in the neighborhoods that we live, we will build a community where we get to know everyone. Start your countdown. 8 neighbors. We'll see how many of our 8 neighbors we'll get to know in the next few weeks. Amen? With that, we're going to sing our closing song, How Can We Name a Love, 111, in our United Methodism. I invite you to stand as you're able.
Thank you.
As we go forward then, maybe go live a life that reflects the love of God to our neighbors. Get to know our neighbors. Share our lives with our neighbors, that our communities may be transformed by Christ's love through us. Amen. We have a benediction that is going to be a sung benediction, and that is going to be on Eagle's Wings. So I invite you all, if you are able or willing, to hold hands with your neighbor as we sing our sung benediction. Amen. I invite you to be seated for the postlude.